Good morning. Hi, guys. I'm Amanda Galvinci. I am not Jennifer Huff. I'm Grandma Modi's granddaughter and Terry's oldest daughter. So welcome. Thank you for coming to celebrate Grandma Modi, Rosemary. Those of you who drove in, flew in, traveled, we appreciate you. Just welcome. We're happy to have you here. And I'm going to turn this over to Tammy, who's going to lead us in a prayer.
If you'll please stand for prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for bringing everyone here safely to honor the beautiful Modi. Be with each and every one of us today as we remember everything about her and all the things that that she's touched us about. Please bless Terry as she comes up tonight, today, and delivers her beautiful eulogy of her mother. I pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Rosemary Lou Fredericks Fulton of Lubbock was born June 11, 1935 in Minden, Nebraska, to Carlisle Ernest Fredericks and Pansy Alice Youngson Fredericks. She graduated from Lubbock High School. She married Gerald H. Fulton on June 11, 1953 in Lubbock. He passed away May 14th of 2020. Rosemary was a founding member of Mary Mixer's Square Dance Club, and she square danced up until 3 years ago. She was very talented with her hands. She taught knitting and crochet and was a fabulous seamstress. She enjoyed her cats far too much, going bowling, fishing, and going to bingo. She was a member of Redbud Baptist Church and enjoyed Bible study fellowship. Rosemary went to be with the Lord on Wednesday, December 14th, 2022. Her parents, husband, granddaughter Brina Ann Huff, a grandson Matthew Ethan Tice, and great-grandchild Eli Ethan were all there to greet her. She left to cherish her memory, Teresa Rose Henderson and her husband Richard, Jennifer Ann Huff and her husband Joe Lee, and Gerald Fulton and wife Jamie, five grandchildren, Amanda Galbancy and her husband John, Chad Huff, Aaron Parker Adkins and Brad, Jacob Fulton and Nikki and Joshua Fulton, and six great-grandchildren, Eleanor Rose Galbancy, Andrew Michael Galbancy, Shelby Adkins, Atticus Adkins, and Matthew and Joseph Fulton.
No. Good morning. That was Mom's favorite hymn. And who better to do that than Elvis? The day she dies, a piece of you will die too. You'll learn this is a piece that cannot be filled. It is a piece that cannot be replaced by anything. The day she dies, you'll stop breathing for a moment too, and you'll wonder, how can the world go on? The day she dies, you'll start a new life. Your new life will be motherless. It will be different than before in the most painful and heartbreaking way. The day she dies, you will look around and question everything. You'll question your faith, your last words with her, and every moment you spent away from her. Your questions will never be answered, but keep asking them anyway. The day she dies, you'll be in complete disbelief, and you will refuse to accept the reality, but it will stay with you. One day, the debilitating reality will sink in, and that day is more difficult than the day she dies. The day she dies, you will be frozen with heartbreak and confusion and terror. You will develop new anxiety and fear that you never had before. Some days, these fears will debilitate you. The day she dies, you become an adult. The kind of adult that doesn't have a mother, and that is a different kind of adult than before, trust me. The day she dies, you will long for her hug, her kiss, her time, and her presence. That longing never goes away. It stays with you, but so does she. The day she dies, you gain the most beautiful angel. You can't see her, but she is there, just like she promised that she would be. The day she dies, you will look back and be grateful for all the people that supported you and help you pick up the pieces. The people who showed up are your people. Never forget the ones that showed up. They are special. The day she dies, you'll learn that you loved so hard and so deeply and so purely that you will now grieve hard because of that beautiful love. The day she dies, you'll learn that she loved you beyond measure. She mothered you more beautifully than a Hallmark movie. She believed in you more than you'll ever believe in yourself. You'll realize that she took care of you like you were the most precious cargo on the planet, even as an adult. The day she dies, you'll realize without hesitation that she was the most amazing woman you will ever know. The day she dies, you will appreciate her more than you ever have. And you'll pray to have her back. Unfortunately, no prayers can bring her back. No wishes will make her appear. So when she dies, remember her smile. Remember her love and remember her life. Never forget her and everything that she was, because the day she dies, you become her legacy. So since the day Mom left me, I have been wondering, how can I eulogize her? How do you crowd in a lifetime of memories and love in 20 minutes? How do I tell everyone everything they need to know to really be able to appreciate who she was and what made her that way? And I can only try. I asked a few people to give me just a short idea of what comes to your mind when you think about Mother. And her sister Annie, who's here, said she was never very intellectual, but very talented. She was always hardworking and never bitter. My Uncle Jim, who's here, he said, she expressed herself with what she could do with her hands. She could do anything with men's coats. She was sparkly. My husband Rick said she was pragmatic, witty, intelligent, and loving. Her granddaughter Amanda said, Grandmother was always fiercely outspoken, even when her words could hurt feelings. And her words were almost always correct, even when you didn't want to hear it. My mom was beautiful. That blonde hair and blue-eyed girl was stunning. As a child, she loved to swim, and the chlorine from the neighborhood swimming pool turned her hair bright green. There was a hole at the pool where people could look in and watch you swim, and you could look out at them while you were swimming. And I'm sure that that was very entertaining, because she loved to swim down to that hole and look out. And you know that was pretty colorful, looking at that green-haired child swimming, looking back at you. My grandma Pansy used to say that having one Modi was like having three more kids. She was always busy and exploring and full of it. Mom never said what it was, but I'm sure it was curious and it was exploring spirit inside her, and it was precociousness. Being raised on a farm provided much to explore. She was the youngest of three, with an older brother, Alan, and an older sister, Ann. In Minden, Nebraska, they were surrounded by family on both sides. Can you imagine? They always had cousins around and friends, and Mom said at Christmas, they all gathered together to celebrate. She said it was very meager. Sometimes the kids would just get one gift, but she never noticed. It was always filled with love and fun and happiness, and my grandma would dress up as Santa. She was short, spunky little lady. And Mom said the kids never knew who Santa was, but it was Grandma Pansy. They'd wander the town and they would play games, and Annie said hopscotch was a favorite for Mom, and they would climb huge trees. And then they would, each branch of the tree would be a different room, and who lived here and who lived there, and could you go visit that person? And can you just imagine walking down the city streets and all the trees are full of kids? What a way to grow up, right? Mom was fond of visiting the old people in town. Now, I don't know by a child standard if old was 40 or 50, but she loved the old people. And she said their stories were always fascinating. And she could talk to them for hours. I bet there was some homemade cookies involved with that, but it was a small town. Mom was a twirler in school. When she was 14, they moved to Lubbock. By all accounts, Mom was popular and made friends easily. Her sister and her helped out at the hotel that her parents managed, and they would clean. And I can tell you that until Mom left us, if she was in my house, she would go, "You need to clean that. Okay, Mom, you need to clean that." They went to the Presbyterian church, and in her things, I found her baptismal certificate. She was 3 years old. Mom was definitely a child of God. They loved to swim at McKenzie Park when she was here in Lubbock, and she was a diver and a lifeguard. At 16, real life stepped in. Mom found herself to be an unwed mother, and she was sent away, as was sometimes the choice for young women in those circumstances. I want you to think about that. She was 16 and sent away. I didn't know until a few months ago that not even her siblings knew where she was or why. They had family that lived in California, and they thought she had gone to visit family. My grandma visited her a few times, but it was hard to get there, but she got packages in the mail, and some of the handiwork on the table, the dish towels, are some of the handiwork that Mom filled her time with. They're intricate and lovely, and you can see where they would take time. She said they stayed busy with chores there, but the girls really didn't bond because they were all confused and scared and a little overwhelmed. So Mom said she prayed. She would pray to Jesus to help her be strong, and she would talk to him like they were in that garden from the hymn that she loved so much. It was a lonely time. And you can feel that thinking about her being sent away from her family. She was delivered of a daughter, and then she came home, and she was eager to talk about how that had changed her life and how that felt and how happy she was to be home. And she was told, "Don't speak of it again. Move on." At 16, she learned hardship and fortitude without bitterness, and she learned faithfulness. She married my dad on her 18th birthday, and she devoted herself to being a good wife and a great stay-at-home mom. That was pretty common for mothers to stay at home, and she was really well-suited to both. She was a really involved mother, a very hands-on mother. She sewed our clothes, and I had a different dress for each day of the first month when I started school. Some were frilly and some were plain, but my mother made them, and I loved wearing them, and they held up well. They were passed down to my sister and my cousins. And then they were probably passed down to their friends. I was a campfire girl, and you know, you get beads by doing tasks, kind of like a Boy Scout, only you got beads. And she made me a vest with my beads hanging off, and it was creative and colorful, and I was so proud to wear that. And you know, my friends were a little bit jealous, but I loved my mother, and I loved that vest. There wasn't anything that she couldn't do with thread or textiles. And later in life, when my dad was incapacitated by several strokes, she worked full-time as a seamstress for the Fit Shop and at Dillard's, and she worked on the men's coats and in the men's department, and she did alterations from our home. My mom was a dancer. When her and my dad started square dancing and round dancing, she made the club banners and the club dresses. I remember in one of the rooms, they had bolts of fabric all piled up, and the other ladies brought their machines, and they were all just sewing away. She loved dancing. My dad and my mom were graceful, and they were beautiful on the dance floor, and I could see her whispering, "Hold me tighter, stand straighter. There's the beat, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. And I loved to watch them dance. They floated. I think it was an outward way to express the inner spirit of joy inside her. And when I went back to square dancing 6 years ago, she excitedly said, "I'm going too." It's okay. And it was so much fun to have her there. And she danced until, like my brother said, 3 years ago. You know, you can tell a lot about a person's heart if they love animals. And my mother loved animals. She loved human babies and animal babies. We had dogs and bunnies and cats, and we had piglets. My dad was in the pig business, and there were some orphaned little piglets, and she brought them into town. We lived behind Market Street on 52nd in Indiana, and we had piglets. They were named Bonnie and Clyde, so that tells you what time of culture it was. They stayed in our backyard, and they'd come in and root pillows around the room. They were smart. And the neighbors would bring their grandkids and knock on the door and say, "Can we play with your piglets? Can we see your pigs?" She loved baby animals, and they stayed in the backyard until they dug up a rose bush, and then they figured, "Yes, okay. Better take you out to the farm." You know, Clyde was so devoted and so tame that he wouldn't breed, and Bonnie would hardly have babies, just a few, and then we had to sell her. Like my little brother said, she had a slew of cats. But she loved animals, and my dogs loved her. When she began to go deaf from a genetic disorder, I was just beginning to play the guitar. And I would come in from school, and she'd say, "Get your guitar and sit on the end of my bed and play." I only knew 5 songs from beginning to end. And she would say, "Play that again. Play that over. I want to hear that again." You know, now that I'm older, I can see that there probably was some fear and questioning, and am I going deaf? I want to hear her play. Talk to me. I want to hear you talk. But I never heard her say anything about that. Hearing aids were very hard to get at that time, and she found a way to get them, and she put them in and moved on. Mom was a teacher. It takes a very special person to teach someone how to knit or crochet or spin their own yarn. And there's a lot here that can tell you that she taught them and won ribbons at the fair. She was a good teacher, obviously. They wouldn't let Mom enter her stuff at the fair because she was a professional. But her work is beautiful. And every piece that she ever made for me, I have it, I wear it, and now I cherish it. You know, it takes a special teacher to say, tear that out, do it again, pick it back up, you can do it. You can do this. You can do this. She taught knitting at Sears and then at the library for 20 years or so, even up until a few weeks before she got sick. You know, she could watch a YouTube video and pick up a set of needles and do it. That's a talent. She was a gifted artist. My brother and my sister and I have paintings that Mom painted, and they are filled with nuance, and they're filled with a good eye for color. They're filled with emotion. Now I wish I had asked her, why did you paint that? They have blue bonnets and windmills, and that daughter from Nebraska moved to Texas and embraced it. She taught Sunday school, and she worked in the church office, and she was always present. Mom had a competitive spirit. I don't know if y'all know this, but Mom was very good at games. She had that killer instinct. She liked to gamble and play bingo, and they would go to El Paso to the dog races, and she would take a small amount of money and study the program at night, and they would go to the dog races the next day, and she never met a stranger there. She was very competitive, and she was a winner. We came home with money. There was one time, and I was about probably 11, and we went to El Paso, and she made friends with a couple that was there that didn't speak English, and they had a new baby. And she picked up that baby and loved it and enjoyed it, and they didn't speak English. And somehow they invited us to go down into Juarez to their house for supper. I was terrified the whole time, terrified that we would not be able to get back. And we came back and they met a new couple and didn't even share the language, and she met them and we went to their home. Mom loved bowling. When I came home after a divorce, I was excited. I joined her team, and Friday nights, I'd get my ball and shoes and go down there, and I was bowling with Mom. It was Mom and my cousin Joreen and a friend Diana and Jennifer and me were on the team. One Friday night, I came in after work, and I got my shoes. I'm all prepared, and I go down there, and Dad's sitting there sipping on a beer after work. And I'm like sitting in my place, and Mom goes, come down here, I want you to meet this other girl. I was like, okay. She goes, let's go down there and meet Vicky because she just got divorced and y'all have something in common. I said, okay, but I said, Mom, aren't we gonna start bowling? She said, you can't bowl. Your bowling is bad. Your lift is bad. You got to turn on your ball. I've tried to teach you how to bowl. You cannot bowl. You cannot be on my team. You're going to go down here and be on this team. True story. I said, Dad, she's kicking me off her team. He said, I know. I'll send you a margarita. Go on down there with your mother. She had spunk. She had grace and courage and hope. And I cannot tell you the times in my life that I didn't even want to get up off that floor and I didn't want to breathe. I had lost everything. And I mean everything. And I just couldn't do it. And I didn't want to. I quit school twice, and she marched me up to the office and said, put her back in school. She's finishing. She's going to make something of her life. She had spunk. She picked me up and dusted me off, and she told me, move on. Face it and move on. If it's your mistake, admit to it and fix it. If it isn't, make it better and move on. She always told me. On the times that I said, Mom, I don't know how to raise kids. I don't know what to say. I don't know what to do. She said, you teach your children about God and you teach them to swim, and that will cover everything. That's pragmatic. And she would say, pray about it. Tell Jesus about it. He will fix it. He will take care of you. He will hold you. He will shelter you. He loves you. Give it to God. Don't carry that around. Drop it off and move on. In her life, my mother was physically challenged. She was psychologically wounded, but she faced it. She faced it all with endurance and fortitude and faith, an unquestioning faith, an undeniable faith. She faced her life that way, her trials that way, and in that tradition, she faced her death that way. My mother knew her Creator. She knew where her mother was. In the morning that she left us, she told me, I have been without my mother a long time. I want to hold my mother. I want to talk to my mother, and I want to praise my Creator. I'm going to hold my mother for a long time. I'm going to love my Jesus. I'm going to kick your daddy's butt. I didn't go there. I didn't know. But she was ready, and she knew where she was going, and she was ready to see her mother. And believe me, I am ready to see mine. She lost her mother when I was 11, and I had never seen my mother cry. And she cried a lot. And I was scared as an 11-year-old. And I wouldn't go anywhere but school, and I wouldn't play with my friends, and I would stay with her, stay at the house, talk to her, help her. And after a while, she figured something was different. And she said, "What's wrong with you?" And I cried and I said, "I'm so afraid that you are going to die like Grandma. And I'm scared." And she said, "Someday I will. But I'm not going anywhere for a long time. And at night I would pray that God would let me have my mother for a long, long time." And she said, "Now, you go be with your friends and you go play at school and do what you need to do. I'm going to be here." My mother loved us sternly and softly. She loved us happily and stubbornly and judgingly, but she loved us fairly. Irritatingly, imperfectly, but always, my mother loved us completely. I am grateful. I am grateful for her courage, her character built from adversity. I am grateful for her common sense. I miss her laughter. I loved her quirkiness, her naughtiness, her honesty, her wisdom, her lessons, and her love. I am grateful for her goodness and faithfulness. I am so blessed to be one of her legacies. You see her other ones here. She loved us all with abandon. And I thank you, my Father, for giving me this amazing woman for 68 years. You answered my prayer, and I am grateful and thankful. And you're right, Uncle Jim. She was sparkly.
You guys have to bear with me if I stutter and get worked up a little bit. I know we're all pretty worked up today. I'd like to begin by reading my favorite verse of scripture. It isn't necessarily associated with death, but it speaks to the hope of those who have faith in God. That the things in this world that are impossible, the natural things, and of the sorrows that we feel as a result of them, aren't the same with God. And those of us who believe in Christ, we don't have to fear death because we know this isn't the end. And we've been given hope through Scripture. And I'd like to perhaps a little, maybe a little bit today, if it's possible, and I can get through it, extend to you guys a little bit of that hope. We read in the book of Isaiah words to a suffering people, people who had just seen their city destroyed and many of their family members killed by invaders. The Lord speaks to them and comforting them. Sing, O barren woman, you who never bore a child. Burst into song. Shout for joy, you who were never in labor. Because more are the children of the desolate woman than of her who has a husband, says the Lord. We know, of course, this speaks of Sarah, the wife of Abraham, who, because of natural causes, was kept from bearing new life. But through God, all things are possible. And we, of course, know what happened. The desolate woman bore a child who became a nation and who is more numerous than the stars. There are many passages of Scripture that speak on death. And as it's something that we all have to deal with. In the book of Romans, it is written, For your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. And of course, today and especially, we could be said to share our thoughts and feelings with those of Martha and the family of Lazarus and all who loved him. Of course, he had died, and everyone was very, very broken about it. But we know what happens in this story. Lord, Martha said to Jesus, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But I know that even now God will give you whatever you ask. Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. Martha answered, as we so often answer, yes, of course, in the future. Martha answered, I know he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day. But Jesus says to her, I am the resurrection and the life. And the one who believes in me will live, even though they die. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this? Concerning this, we read, concerning this hope that we have in Christ, the Apostle Paul writes in 1 Corinthians, now, brothers and sisters, I want to remind of you the gospel I preached to you, which you have received and which you have taken your stand, and in which you have taken your stand. By this gospel you are saved, if you hold firmly to the word I preached to you. Otherwise you have believed in vain. For what I received, I passed on to you as of first importance, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day according to the Scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, and then to the 12. After that, he appeared to 500 of the brothers and sisters at the same time, most of whom are still living, though some have fallen asleep. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles, and last of all he appeared to me also, as to one abnormally born. But Christ has indeed been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For since death came through a man, the resurrection of the dead comes also through a man. For as in Adam all die, so in Christ, all will be made alive. But each in turn, Christ, the first fruits, then, when he comes, those who belong to him. Then the end will come, when he hands over the kingdom to God the Father, after he has destroyed all dominion, authority, and power. For he must reign until he has put all his enemies under his feet. The last enemy to be destroyed is death. For he has put everything under his feet. Now when it says that everything has been put under him, it is clear that this does not include God himself, who put everything under Christ. When he has done this, then the Son himself will be made subject to him who put everything under him, so that God may be all in all. Concerning this hope we have, we read in the book of Hebrews, the second chapter, it is not to angels that he has subjected the world to come, about which we are speaking. But there is a place where someone has testified. What is man that you are mindful of him? The son of man that you care for him? You made him a little lower than the angels, yet you crowned him with glory and honor and put everything under their feet. In putting everything under them, God left nothing that is not subject to them. Yet at present, we do not see everything subject to them. But we do see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels for a little while, now crowned with glory and honor because he suffered death, so that by the grace of God, he might taste death for everyone. In bringing many sons and daughters to glory, it was fitting that God, for whom and through whom everything exists, should make the pioneer of their salvation perfect through what he suffered. Both the one who makes people holy and those who are made holy are of the same family. So Jesus is not ashamed to call them brothers and sisters. He says, I will declare your name to my brothers and sisters, and in the assembly I will sing your praises. And again, I will put my trust in him. And again, he says, here am I, and the children God has given me. Since the children have flesh and blood, he too shared in their humanity, so that by his death, he might break the power of him who holds the power of death, that is the devil, and free those who all their lives were held in slavery by their fear of death. Again in 1 Corinthians, Paul goes on to say, the body that is sown is perishable. It is raised imperishable. It is sown in dishonor. It is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness. It is raised in power. It is sown a natural body. It is raised a spiritual body. If there is a natural body, there is also a spiritual body. So it is written, the first man, Adam, became a living being. The last Adam, a life-giving spirit. The spiritual did not come first, but the natural, and after that, the spiritual. The first man was of the dust of the earth. The second man is of heaven. As with the earthly man, so are those who are of the earth. And as is the heavenly man, so also those are of heaven. And just as we have borne the image of the earthly man, so shall we bear the image of the heavenly man. I declare to you, brothers and sisters, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We will not all sleep, but we will all be changed in a flash, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will be changed. For the perishable must clothe itself with imperishable, and the mortal with immortality. When the perishable has been clothed with the imperishable and the mortal with immortality, then the saying that is written will come true. Death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God. He gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my brothers and sisters, stand firm. Let nothing move you. Always give yourselves fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that your labor is not in vain. Your labor in the Lord is not in vain. Now, Paul was writing probably sometime in the first century AD. Biblical scholarship disagrees, but as I close today, with this second to last passage, we jump 800 years before the time of Christ, before anybody knew anyone of the anything but hopes, just as we know now, just as we have now. All they had was a shadow of what was to come. All they had were scriptures and hopes and vague prophecies. But as we know, those were fulfilled in Christ. So as we jump back 800 years from the writings of Paul, to the book of Isaiah, I share one of my favorite passages that brings me hope from time to time. It is God himself who is speaking. For behold, I will create a new heavens and a new earth. The former things will not be remembered, nor will they come to mind. But be glad and rejoice forever in what I create. For I will create Jerusalem to be a joy, and its people to be a delight. I will rejoice in Jerusalem and take delight in my people. The sounds of weeping and crying will no longer be heard in her. Never again will a nursing infant live but a few days, or an old man fail to live out his years. For the youth will die at 100 years, and he who fails to reach 100 years will be considered accursed. They will build houses and dwell in them. They will plant vineyards and eat their fruit. No longer will they build houses for others to inhabit, nor plant for others to eat. For as the lifetime of a tree, so will be the days of my people. And my chosen ones will fully enjoy the work of their hands. They will not labor in vain or bear children doomed to disaster, for they will be a people blessed by the Lord, they and their descendants with them. Before they call, I will answer. And as they are still speaking, I will hear. The wolf and the lamb will feed together, and the lion will eat straw like the ox, but the food of the serpent will be dust. They will neither harm nor destroy on all my holy mountain. But it's not in the ancient past that I'd like to call and leave you guys with. It is to the future. And far from one of the oldest books of the Bible, I leave you with the last. After this I looked, and there before me was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, tribe, people, and language, standing before the throne and before the Lamb. They were wearing white robes and were holding palm branches in their hands. And they cried out in a loud voice, "Salvation belongs to our God, who sits on the throne and to the Lamb." All the angels were standing around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures. They fell down on their faces before the throne and worshiped God, saying, "Amen. Praise and glory and wisdom and thanks and honor and power and strength be to our God forever and ever. Amen." Then one of the elders asked me, "These in white robes, who are they and where did they come from?" I answered, "Sir, you know." And he said, "These are they who have come out of the great tribulation. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. They are before the throne of God and serve him day and night in his temple. And he who sits on the throne will shelter them with his presence. Never again will they hunger. Never again will they thirst. The sun will not beat down on them, nor any scorching heat. For the Lamb at the center of the throne will be their shepherd. He will lead them to springs of living water. And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes."
I want to thank all of you for being here again. What a legacy that she has. If anyone wants to share a memory, I've got one that I want to give to you. She had been sick for quite a while. She'd been sick and in the hospital. The way her doctor described it is she is the one person that he didn't want to get COVID and get sick. So many of us have lived through this pandemic. We've lost so many of our loved ones, all of us. And all of us have been touched in some way, including her. But she had been sick for a while. She hadn't eaten very much. She knew the end was near. Terry said it very well. Mom had a recurring theme in her life. Move on. This happened. Move on. Move to the next thing. God's taking care of you. That morning she died, she called Jamie and I at 5 a.m. She said, "I'm feeling great today. I'm having my coffee and I'm drinking my Glucerma." She said, "How's Jamie? She hasn't felt well. How's she doing?" And that was her way. That was her way of telling us, "I'm fine." Move. So, take your memories of her. Take what she taught you, because she taught us all something. She was always teaching. And move on. Because we'll see her again. But thank you for being here. Thank you for sharing this with us. And if anyone wants to share anything else. Sure. Anyone else? Again, thank you all for being here. Thank you for loving her. Thank you for being God's instrument to her. She had a faith that never quit, absolutely never quit. And that faith that she had in her Lord, she has in her Lord to take care of you too. So thank you all very much. Thank you for being here and thank you for honoring her. We love you and we appreciate you.
For those of you I haven't met, I'm Rick Henderson. I'm Terry's husband. And I've had the pleasure to call Modi Mom for 30 years or so, living next door. Sweetheart, I knew you could talk a lot, but I never have listened to you until today. And that was a beautiful obituary, it really was. I was supposed to down to read a scripture, but the other day, as normal, when the weather's nice in the mornings, relatively cool, I'll have my coffee out on the patio. And I was sitting there and admiring Modi's rose bushes. And prior to this hail that we had, they were all in blossom. There's the yellows, beautiful pink, and a garnet red. And I was looking at them, and she loved her roses. And I thought, well, how appropriate. We need to celebrate that about her. And so I looked through my collection of different poems, and I found this short poem, so I'm closing with a short poem, that spoke to me. Matter of fact, I used it, I read it as a prayer myself, but I thought it said, from my heart to Modi, kind of how I felt. The author's unknown. It was written late 1800s. And it's called If Flowers Grow in Heaven. If flowers grow in heaven, Lord, then pick a bunch for me. Then place them in my mother's arms and tell her they're from me. Tell her that I love her and miss her, and when she turns to smile, place a kiss upon her cheek and hold her for a while. Thank you.
If I had only known the last time would be the last time, I would have put off all the things I had to do. I would have stayed a little longer, held on a little tighter. Now what I'd give for one more day with you. Cause there's a wound here in my heart where something's missing, and they tell me that it's gonna heal with time. But I know you're in a place where all your wounds have been erased, and knowing yours are healed is healing mine. The only scars in heaven, it won't be long to me and you. There'll be no such thing as broken, and all the old will be made new. And the thought that makes me smile now, even as the tears fall down, is that the only scars in heaven are on the hands that hold you now. I know the road you walked was anything but easy. You picked up your share of scars along the way. Oh, but now you're standing in the sun. You fought your fight and your race is run. The pain is all a million miles away.
the only scars in heaven. It won't belong to me and you. There'll be no such thing as broken, and all the old will be made new. And the thought that makes me smile, tears fall down, is that the only scars in heaven, yeah, are on the hands that hold you now. Not a day goes by that I don't see you. You live on in all the better parts of me. Until I'm standing with you in the sun, I'll fight this fight and this race I'll run. Until I finally see what you can see. Oh, the only scars in heaven, they won't belong to me and you. There'll be no such thing as broken, and all the old will be made new. And the thought that makes me smile now, and even as the tears fall down, is that the only scars in heaven? The hands that hold you now.